So going back po mga kapatid, let's have a quick review. I think this is our third week on studying on the lesson of, on the life of Desiderius Erasmus. We studied the life of Desiderius Erasmus. Just maybe you are just curious kung ilang hanggang ano bang year si Desiderius Erasmus po mga kapatid. Desiderius Erasmus is ang kanyang buhay is from 14, okay? From 1466 po mga kapatid all the way to 1536. Okay, you might wonder, ilang taon po 'yan? 70 years old. Madaling namatay, no? Madaling namatay yan sa bata yan sa kanilang panahon. By the way, he did not die as a martyr, but he died, mga kapatid, sa sakit, no? Okay? Or tanda, no? So, yun po. So, 1466 to 1536. Yun po ang kanya pong taon kung saan siya ginagamit po ng Panginoon. So, we spend the time on the first meeting natin. We spend the time on looking at the life of Erasmus po mga kapatid. And also the Erasmus Greek New Testament, although hindi natin ito natapos nung first meeting. Nung second meeting natin, na-discuss natin yung Erasmus Greek New Testament at saka yung Erasmus on Lexicons and Inspiration, yung view niya sa lexicon and inspiration. And we also look at Erasmus and Vernacular Bibles. Okay, so ngayon, Lord willing, matapos natin itong lahat na ito, sunod po mga kapatid, ano significance po nito, pag-uusapan po natin ngayon. So very important na bakit siya behind the King James, behind the English Bibles, dahil ang Greek New Testament ni Erasmus becomes the prominent source, okay, of text in translation, not only ng King James translators, but even kay William Tyndale and also to the King James translators. Okay? So, dapat maintindihan natin yan kasi napaka-importante na mapag-aralan po natin. So, on the life of Erasmus, we studied po mga kapatid dito po sa buhay niya when he was in Holland. Taga-Holland po siya po mga kapatid. He was raised there. He was raised by a scribe or copyist ng salita ng Diyos. That's his father. At the age of 6 years old po mga kapatid, he was already trained to copy the scriptures, but they died early. He was orphaned po mga kapatid. And ang kanya pong guardian na nagte-take care sa kanila, iniwanan sila ng counting substance ng kanilang parents. Pero pinadala po siya sa seminaryo, sa monastery po mga kapatid. Pinadala po siya, nagiging monk po siya to study for being monk. So becoming an Augustinian monk po mga kapatid. So he studied there out, hindi sa kanyang kagustuhan. Pero of course, since guardian niya yun, yun ang gusto mangyayari. Pero nag-graduate po siya doon po mga kapatid, pero hindi siya nag-practice pagkapare. Okay, meron na po siyang ano po mga kapatid, nakikita po natin ang kanya pong intawag yung nabasa natin yung biography niya or napakinggan natin na i-share ko sa inyo na kung paano po mga kapatid na against his will, against sa kanyang kagustuhan at doon. At nung siya po ay naka-graduate doon sa monasteryo, ay pumunta siya ng Paris para mag-aral ng doctorate. Si University of Paris po mga kapatid, France, para mag-aral ng doctorate. At isa po sa kanyang reason din, pumunta siya doon para magkaroon siya ng access sa mga library sa Paris. So mga library dahil ang kanya pong nagiging passion ay kagaya ng kanyang tatay at ng kanyang parents nung simula pa siya ay maliit. Amen. So magko-collect ng mga manuscript, magkukopya ng manuscript, isa 'yun sa mga desire niya na ang magkaroon po ng mapag-aralan at magkaroon ng perfect, okay, perfect or I mean accurate or ano po mga kapatid, or reliable or good na Greek text para sa kanilang kapanahunan. So after that po mga kapatid, he went to Italy and isa sa pinaka-reason niya bakit kailangan niyang pumunta ng Rome or Italy. Dahil po mga kapatid ay gusto niyang makuha yung lahat na kasi ang pinaka-center of the world pagdating sa mga literature, pagdating sa mga naka-preserve na mga writings is nasa Italy. Nandun yung mga great libraries po doon. So, to have access sa lahat ng libraries, so talagang inubos niya lahat ng library para makuha niya lahat ng mga nakatago doon, nakatambak doon na mga manuscript from many vernaculars or from many languages po, mga kapatid. So, that would, by the way, in this study, dito niya nakikita yung mga horrors and errors ng Catholicism. Si Erasmus, dito niya nakikita yung mga kapatid, yung corruption, yung ginagawa ng mga monk and priests, in-expose po niya, in which we will talk about that as we go on dito po, Erasmus and Jesus Christ and dito sa Rome. Okay? So anyway, napag-usapan natin a little bit sa kanya mga letters last time. And of course, pagkatapos niya nakuha na lahat po mga kapatid, around 1500, pumunta na po siya sa England. In 1500, pumunta na po siya sa England po mga kapatid, at doon siya nag-spend, doon niya ginather at pinoformulate ang kanyang Greek edition po mga kapatid. Itong Greek New Testament, doon na niya inano sa England. He spent most of his time na doon, at doon na natapos ang kanya pong Greek New Testament. So we look at also in his Greek New Testament, and I don't have to go over itong edition ng 1516, 1519, 1522, 1527, 1536. Bakit may ganun? May editions po mga kapatid. Kasi ito mga 1516 at 1519 po mga kapatid, ito yung wala pa, hindi pa niya nakuha lahat. So nung naka-discover ulit siya ng other pang manuscript na mayroon palang mga nakurap at wala dito, so dinagdag niya dito sa 1522. At isa po doon yung Johannine 1 John 5:7, at yun po yung pinaka importante na controversy na tinanggal po ng maraming manuscript na nakita niya, pero nakuha niya sa Old Itala, which pag-usapan natin the Itala Bible po mga kapatid, ang mga bagay na ito nakita niya. So nagkaroon ng 1522 all the way to 1536, nagkaroon na ng 1 John 5:7, which is ang 1522, this was the edition na ginamit po ni William Tyndale sa kanyang translation. Ang 1519, ito po yung ginamit na edition para sa German Bible, so German translation ni Martin Luther. And in 1536, ito yung ginamit po ng King James translators. Okay? The final edition po mga kapatid ng mga King James translators. So nakitaan po natin so yung importance. And ito po yung connection, anong relevance itong Greek New Testament. By the way, we studied about that his Greek New Testament was consistent with the 5,200 na mga manuscript available today. So hindi siya minority but majority. That's why doon nakabrand sa kanya yung Textus Receptus. Pero that's a myth na ang Textus Receptus hindi nagsastart kay Erasmus. Before Erasmus came, marami ng Textus Receptus. Kaya lang doon lang nakaano sa kanya. Ano ba yung Textus Receptus na sinasabi? Ang Textus Receptus, number one, myth number one, it's not Greek only. But it is composed of vernacular Bibles like French, like Dutch, like Latin, like Greek, like Hebrew, and many, many, many Bibles. So, bakit siya? Why Textus Receptus? Hindi, Recepta, ibig sabihin, Receptus, plural po mga kapatid. Textus, text means, or Receptus, or received text, okay? Okay, received text, okay? So, kung makita po natin po mga kapatid, ay received text ang paggagamit dahil ito ang Bible na hindi galing sa Catholic. Ito yung mga Bible na in-embrace ng mga Christians even before the Reformation, long before the Reformation. These are the texts, whether anong language, na recommended and used by the Bible believers, okay, throughout history. That's why it's called Textus Receptus. It started po mga kapatid even ang term lang na Textus Receptus, it was made known around yung time ng 1500, which is sa kalakasan po ni, that's why naka-coined sa kanya. Pero ang katotohanan, ang Erasmus Greek text could be considered as text one of the Textus Receptus, but not the only Textus Receptus. Pero ang kanyang source din ng Erasmus Greek text is from the Textus Receptus. Ang dami, oh, ito from Itala Bible, the Gothic Bible, Anglo-Saxon Bible, German Bible, Dutch, French, Spanish, and even earlier English translation like the Wycliffe Bible. So these are considered as the received text. At hindi lang yan po mga kapatid. This is just limited to the sources kung saan po nagiging tulong kay Erasmus po mga kapatid sa pagbuo. Nakita nyo po. So ang King James Bible, ang beloved King James Bible natin, could be considered also as Textus Receptus. You know why? Because it was used in the whole Christianity for 400 years. For almost 300 years, there's only one English Bible that is accepted to the English-speaking country or English-speaking world po mga kapatid. And that's the King James Bible, recommended by churches, by mga ministers of God, and by saints po mga kapatid. It's received and it's well-beloved. That's why it's also considered as one of the Textus Receptus. Kaya huwag tayong magpagoyo, huwag po tayong magpa-deceive po mga kapatid sa mga quote-unquote na mga Greek teachers na dadayain ka, Textus Receptus, mga minority naman yung Textus Receptus na yan at whatever po mga kapatid. Wrong. At ang thinking din lang, ang Textus Receptus, Greek lang naman yan. So sometimes mga kapatid, there are people who just parrot other people who are also ignorant of history. And that's very sad po mga kapatid. We're not trying to claim that we're master in history, but at least po mga kapatid, that's the basic thing that you and me should know, that Textus Receptus is not Greek only po mga kapatid, okay? Dapat maintindihan, and Textus Receptus is not a minority text, but it's a majority text. Okay? So dapat na ma-establish natin. And thirdly, Textus Receptus did not start with Erasmus. Long before kay Erasmus. But it was termed lang na paggagamit po doon po mga kapatid. Amen. So with that, okay, nakita po natin yung edition. And of course, tiningnan din natin yung Erasmus on lexicon and inspiration. I don't have to go over. May magaganda kong details na diniscuss dito. You watch the previous broadcast natin. Last week and the other week pa po mga kapatid. At makatulong sa inyo yun. Okay? We also look at on Erasmus on lexicons and inspiration po mga kapatid. Lexicons and inspiration. Ano po meron po doon po mga kapatid? Pinag-usapan din doon natin kung anong yung view niya sa mga ginagawa mga dictionaries at ano yung position niya sa inspiration. Now, sa isang translator, napaka-importante tingnan kung ano ang position ng isang translator, kung ano ang inspiration. Kasi may mga translators, even na modern translation, translators ngayon, translators ng NIV at madaming modern version, hindi naniniwala na kanilang, ang meron pa tayong inspired, preserved Word of God ngayon. Hindi sila naniniwala na meron pang inspired, preserved Word of God ngayon. Ang belief nila na ang inspired Word of God is yung Greek original and Hebrew original. At walang translation or Word of God na pipreserve, nandun lang sa original. So, ibig sabihin, very dangerous yung ganong klaseng translators kasi po mga kapatid, nagta-translate sila ng Bible na wala silang belief po mga kapatid na ito ay perpekto, ito ay salita ng Diyos. Kung ganun po ang konsepto, magta-translate ka mga kapatid na walang fear of God. Okay? Walang compelling reason why you have to be faithful on your translations because of that conviction and because of that belief. And be careful sa mga tao na yon. And that's why we always look at, remember when we studied Wycliffe, John Wycliffe, we look at the position of Wycliffe on inspiration and also on those ano po mga kapatid, yung lexicons po mga kapatid. At yung mga Greek and Hebrew or other ano na naka-contain lang doon. Because Erasmus is not original only, John Wycliffe is not original only. Okay, itong mga tao na ito na ginagamit ng Panginoon, they're not original only, but they believe na yung their translations at yung mga product is is also considered as the word of God in their time, in their language, in that particular time po mga kapatid. It was accepted to be the word of God. Okay? So itong mga ano na ito, mga modern versions, be careful. That's why, no wonder, ang daming mga corruptions ngayon sa mga modern version. Kasi yung mga translator mismo, ay they are ano po mga kapatid, doubtful po mga kapatid. Not just doubtful, but they're unbeliever when it comes to the inspiration and the preservation of the Bible, that God can preserve His Word and there's still available perfect Word of God. Importante po yun. Isa po yun sa pinaka-unang credibility. Even credibility, not just a translator, credibility ng isang preacher. May mga pastors ngayon na nagsasabi ang original lang daw ang inspired at wala ng perfect Word of God. Wala silang credibility na magpipreach ngayon po mga kapatid. Okay, there are pastors because of that concept, they try to correct the King James Bible using quote unquote the Greek and the Hebrew kuno, using the lexicon po mga kapatid, but they have no credibility whatsoever po mga kapatid, na ganun po ang konsepto. Wala silang business na mga ngaral, wala silang business po mga kapatid na matawag na man of God. Amen. Basic po yun. Basic na dapat nating test. Do you believe that we have the Word of God available today? That's something. But if they say no, it's only in the original, flee, get out from that place, mga kapatid. That's not a real, ano po mga kapatid, servant of God. Anong reason mo? Because they will attempt to replace the authority of the Word of God by themselves, okay? By themselves. And they will bluntly correct the Word of God or the Bible before your eyes, before your face, po mga kapatid. And they will simply say, oh, the translation of this is the King James have taken this wrongly. It must be translated this way because the Greek word says and that. But be careful sa mga tao na yan po mga kapatid. Mark them down. Mark them down po mga kapatid. Di bali ng pastor po mga kapatid, hindi ganun ka-knowledgeable. Basta alam niya na may perfect Word of God siya sa kanyang kamay and never niyang i-criticize, never niyang i-correct. Bagkos mga kapatid, kahit hindi man siya charismatic, hindi man siya ganun kagalingan na magturo po mga kapatid, but at least you have the right man of God before your face because he believed that he still have the perfect, inerrant, infallible, inspired, preserved Word of God in his hand po mga kapatid. Yun po, test niyo po. And alam niyo po where to trace where the pure Bible is? Hunt these translators who has a very strong belief on inspiration po mga kapatid. And hindi po tayo magpadala, linlang, be careful po tayo sa mga ganong mga tao at marami po yun po mga kapatid. At dapat nating tandaan po yun, no? Dapat tandaan. Hindi kailangan maging matalino, hindi kailangan basta. Ang importante po mga kapatid ay yung belief po ng isang tao po na yan. Amen. Manggagawa po na yan sa salita ng Diyos. Dapat na malinaw po sa kanya, you know, ang belief niya sa salita ng Panginoon. So, sabi ni nga ni Erasmus eh. Sabi nga niya, let me quote, knees, sabi niya, not degrees. It's about knees and not degrees po mga kapatid. So it's a very, yung mga statements na yan, it's not about earning a degree, it's not about the doctorates and all of that, but it's about trusting God. Amen. It's about the power of the Holy Spirit po mga kapatid. Amen. So Erasmus printed that Greek, okay, he printed that Greek New Testament with a belief that Christ is God. Amen. He believed that Christ through the Holy Spirit speaks directly and simply even through the vernacular Bibles. Even through vernacular Bibles. And Erasmus' words bearing repeating po mga kapatid. Paulit-ulit, sinasabi po ni Erasmus, heresy does not arise. He said, heresy does not arise among the laity who have the scriptures in the vernacular, but among the doctors. So he believed that the scripture can be in vernaculars, can be in ano po mga kapatid, in Bible po mga kapatid, in vernacular Bible. That's why makikita natin Erasmus and the vernacular Bibles that he it was preserved, that the Bibles in Itala, Gothic, Anglo-Saxon, German, lahat po na yan, all the way to English po mga kapatid, that the Bible, the inspiration, the scripture can be in other language. Amen. Meron dito mga self-proclaimed na mga Pinoy Rachmanite. They call themselves mga Pinoy Rachmanite. And they don't believe in translation, that the King James Bible can be translated po mga kapatid. They're para bang kung ganun ang konsepto mo, if you don't believe that the King James can be translated po mga kapatid, sana hindi na lang translate sa King James Bible, nandoon na lang sa Greek po mga kapatid. But whether you like it or not, the King James Bible had been translated to thousands of vernaculars and languages all over the world po mga kapatid by this time. Amen. Very, very ano po mga kapatid. I mean, I'm a King James Bible believer only. I'll say that only. I studied in the King James. I preach in the King James. I have never used any other Bible, only the King James. I believe it is inerrant, infallible, inspired, preserved word of God in my hand, in English. Without a doubt po mga kapatid. But I would not dare say that it cannot be translated. It cannot be transferred to other language. That's simply an ignorant claim mga kapatid, if I'll say that. But I'm thankful that I have already, this is already a translation for me. But there are those who cannot understand this. But this perfect text should be transmitted and transferred po mga kapatid. It may not be as beautiful as this. It may not be as majestic as the language itself po mga kapatid. But it could, the truth can be transferred, the spirit can be transferred, and it could provide a clear understanding description on salvation and many, many doctrines po mga kapatid. But I should not dare say that it cannot be translated. But I also say on the other hand, wala pang mga fit na mga translators at wala ding mga faithful na translators that I know po mga kapatid in this time. We need to take note on that. Okay? We need to take note on that. And I despise those ano po mga kapatid, yung mga self-proclaimed na mga real KJB believers. Sila lang daw ang real KJB believers. You're not real KJB believers. You're not real ano po mga kapatid, because KJB believers po mga kapatid, or KJB, even KJB translators acknowledge that do you not know that this Bible, as we go on the King James translators po mga kapatid later on this series, do you not know that our King James Bible is made up of so many languages, combination of so many vernacular Bibles po mga kapatid, that are considered as received text, and combining them together with their gems after gem after gems with many, many dialects and vernaculars, and you know what's the result? A masterpiece. And we have it in the King James Bible. And I believe that this can be translated, and I believe po mga kapatid that this should be the final authority in any translation right now. Not the Greek, but this book. That this book could correct any translation. This book could correct any translation work. Any translation work must conform to the language and to the text of this authorized King James Bible po mga kapatid. And that's what I believe po mga kapatid. And it should be. Amen. Yes, we see their inconsistency. They will say na the King James cannot be translated into another language, pero pag magpipreach sila, tinatagalog. Ano po yun po mga kapatid? Tama yun, Brother Elmer. Tinatagalog ang Bible. Pero ang problema po mga kapatid, pag Tagalog nila, mali nga pag-intindi nila sa English, mali din ang kanilang pagtatagalog. So what I mean is, kung tatagalugin mo lang pala ang verse, I would rather have, mga kapatid, a text po mga kapatid that are edited, that are scrutinized, that are ano po, well-examined na translation, rather than your spontaneous na Tagalog na many times we corrupted. Even myself, I admit that I have corrupted. Amen. You see that, mga kapatid? But we're thankful po mga kapatid. You know, I made a comment yesterday on our preaching that translation is never a barrier to inspiration. But rather po mga kapatid, translation is the bridge to understanding. Translation po mga kapatid is the means of preservation. Because without translation, we could not know Word of God today. Without translation, the Word of God will remain in Greek, will remain in Hebrew, which nobody could understand, which nobody could read, nobody could study, because we're not Greek speakers, we're not Hebrew speakers, and besides that, it's a dead language. It's no longer used. And do you see that, po mga kapatid? And I'll say that, okay? These are same people that who attacked us because we preach the gospel. And I even use and quoted, I post that on my wall, po mga kapatid, concerning Desiderius Erasmus. His very quote, he said, sabi niya, I may be a sheep, amen. I may be a sheep, but a sheep will bleat, amen. Will bleat, amen, if the gospel is being attacked. Amen. This sheep right now is bleating. Amen. Praise God for that. Amen. Glory to God. So, just take note on that. Be careful po mga kapatid. But this translator over here, this man of God over here, believe that the scripture is in the vernaculars. Okay? So, he had left his theological studies at French, at Paris po mga kapatid for this reason. Why? Because the Spirit teaches, not Aristotle, sabi niya. It is the Spirit teaches, not Aristotle. Grace, not reasoning. Sabi niya, inspiration, not syllogism. So that is his quote. Amen. And let me quote sa kanyang sinabi pa. Sabi niya, I advise, okay, divines to leave scholastic or subtleties and study scriptures. Sabi niya, I wish there could be an end of scholastic subtleties, or if not an end, they could be thrust into a second place and Christ be taught plainly and simply. He said, the reading of the Bible will have this effect. Doctrines are taught now which have no affinity with Christ and only darken our eyes. Yun ang ginagawa, yun ang nangyayari. And that's real. And I say amen to that brother Erasmus over there. Amen. So yun po eh. And Erasmus added to those ano mo, mga babes who were not actually bookworms, and he said, he upbraided the Pharisees, let me quote, he upbraided the Pharisees, the scribes, and the doctors of the law, while he sedulously protected the unlearned and multitude. He's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. For what else does, he said, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, mean, but woe to you, wise ones. But he seems to have been wonderfully delighted with children, women, and fishermen. So he quoted Jesus Christ. He said, woe to those doctors. He said, woe to the scholars, but he loves children, fishermen, and women. Ibig sabihin, he loves simple people, not scholarly po mga kabadid. So you see that po mga kabadid. Erasmus said that in vernacular editions of the Gospels and the Epistles, sabi niya, that, let me quote, Christ is more genuinely present than were to view him in the eyes of the flesh, or in view him in the eyes of Latin, which no man could understand. Sabi niya, it's Christ that was presented more, Christ is more genuinely present in vernacular Bibles. Po mga kapatid. Amen. It's a conceited claim, truly, po mga kapatid, na may mga taong ganun, no? So, nakakalungkot. Amen. So, the belief among Christians that vernacular Bibles are truly God's word and not man's words, po mga kapatid, has always been the rule. Amen. Has always been the rule, not the exception. Sa history, ha, it's always been the rule. You know, po mga kapatid, wala po tayong ganung access. Wala pa mga version after version dati, po mga kapatid. Pero makikita nyo po mga kapatid na ang mga tao kinokopya lang ng salita ng Diyos sa language where they can understand po mga kapatid. Kaya nowhere does the Bible say that inspiration was limited to the Greek and ano po or Hebrew alone. Nowhere that you could find that the inspiration is limited to the Greek original and Hebrew original. But rather, listen very carefully, every time you find the word scripture, pag makita mo yung word na scripture in the King James Bible, search the word scripture, none of them is referring to the original. Look at the word scripture in the New Testament, none of them is referring to the original, but they all refer to translations and copies. Copies and translation, but not the original. When Jesus Christ said, search the scripture, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, po mga kapatid. He told the people to search the scripture. There is only one original. If it speaks to the original, nobody could search the scripture. When Christ said, search the scripture, it must mean that the scripture must be available to whom he said, amen, to whom he commanded, amen, to search the scripture. Do you remember the ano po mga kapatid, the Bereans, the noble Bereans, these Bereans were more noble than those of Thessalonica. Why? Because they searched the scripture. What? How often they searched the scripture? Daily. They search the scripture daily. So if that scripture pertains to original and not copies and translation, I'm telling you po mga kapatid, none of those Bereans can search the scripture daily, because it would be unavailable po mga kapatid. If they could search it daily, they must have just like this in their hand that they could daily talk about. You can search the scripture daily right now. Why? Because we have a Bible in our hand. We can do that. But if there's only one original, how could people search? Amen. Anong sabi ng Bible pagdating sa scripture? All scripture is given by inspiration of God. And is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. By the way, you'd like to learn more about that doctrine on inspiration of the scripture, you go back sa mga videos natin, okay? I posted a link po doon. You would like to learn my position about the inspiration, on how we shared and preached on that inspiration, you look at doon. I think that was in part 2 ng video na yon. Ito po ngayon, mga nasa part 35 na tayo po mga kapatid sa ating lesson, if I'm not mistaken. But nasa part 2 po yun. Nasa link na pinost ko po dyan, you could watch there and observe if you'd like to learn more. So I'm just citing things po mga kapatid. No? See, dapat natin maintindihan, no? Itong tao na ito is a believer of inspiration in vernacular. Thank God that he preserved his word and the inspiration did not evaporate doon po sa ano po mga kapatid, doon sa original. Amen. But it is preserved until now, at meron po tayo available, and it can be, amen, written also, transferred sa ibang pang nangangailangan po mga kapatid. Amen. Sa preface, okay, sa preface of Erasmus Greek text, it states, let me read the preface, okay, ng pinakauna, no, sa Erasmus Greek text. So may correction lang tayo, hindi po yan preface, okay, hindi preface but preface, okay. So sabi niya, I would have the weakest woman read the Gospels and the epistles of Saint Paul. I would have those words translated, okay, into all languages. You imagine that? I would have those words translated into all languages, so that not only Scots and Irishmen, but Turks and Saracens might read them. I long for the plowboy to sing them to himself as he follows the plow, and the weaver to hum them to the tune of his shuttle, the traveler to guide with them, amen, sabi niya, to guide with them the dullness of his journey. Other studies we may regret having undertaken, but happy is the man upon whom death comes when he is engaged in this. These sacred words give you the very image of Christ speaking, healing, dying, rising again, and make him so present, mga kapatid, that were before your very eyes would not more truly see him. So that's his view. Amen. And he would like these words to be translated into all languages, and that translation can still be preserved po mga kapatid in these languages. And Erasmus calls for the oracles of God
And sabi niya, do not assume, let me quote, do not assume that you are great doctor of whose wisdom the people should be deprived. Just see what you have at home and bring that to the Lord. He will bless it and give it back to you to distribute. The people will then receive more benefit if some superstitious Pharisee and some arrogant philosopher, some eloquent orator should come with carefully prepared discourse. If some pompous doctor comes announcing that he has more to deliver than time will permit and mysteries to expound, which will be over the heads of his audience, they will go away hungry. Just bring the two little fishes, amen. Bring them to Jesus. Nothing which he has not touched will be of any avail. Ang context po nito, just preach the word of God, even in few words, that people can understand and God would bless it and God would prosper it po, mga kapatid. Kaysa yung mga oration, mga preaching ng mga doctors and scholars, mga kapatid, na hindi ang salita ng Diyos ang tinutukoy po nila. Amen. That's the point, mga kapatid. I'd like you to understand all of this. Okay? So, Erasmus and the vernaculars, and discussed na po natin yan. And this morning, let's add to that. Let's look at Erasmus on Jesus Christ. Importante yun. Very important sa isang translator kung ano ang pagkaintindi niya at pagkakilala niya kay Kristo. Can I give you a very strong warning? The mother of modern versions is the Revised Version. The Revised Version, RV, or the Revised Version was translated by the Westcott and Hort Committee on 1881. The Revised Version, 1881. Now, just think po mga kapatid, the AV is 1611. Just think. How many years from 1611 to 1881, this is the first Revised Version, is the first translation or the first English translation after the King James Bible of 1611. So, this is itong modern era po na ito. By the way, this is now 19th century na makikita po natin that modern era po, mga kapatid. It is already the dawn of the 20th century. Okay, it's already the dawn of the 20th century. Alam niyo po ba ang daming na-develop dito sa 1880s na ito, especially 1850 pataas. Late 1850s po mga, 1800 po mga kapatid. Ang dami pong na-develop dyan. If you study cults, maraming na-develop dito. If you study the charismatic movement, if you study sa mga cults like Jehovah's Witnesses, Seventh-day Adventist, and many, many more, even yung mga Pentecostalism, mga kapatid, developed here. Alam nyo po, look at the secular history, you study kung kailan develop yung evolution theory by Charles Darwin, it's 1800. Saan po naglumabas ang communism? Late 1800. Are you listening? And guess what? Accompanied ang kakontemporary po ng Revised Version, ng modern version, ang kakontemporary po niya, ay yung mga kaguluhan po na yon at yung mga modernism po na yon, kasi that's the age of reason, the Victorian age po mga kapatid, later in the Victorian age, become the age of reason, dito lumabas yung mga humanistic na mga theologies, philosophies po mga kapatid, alongside with communism, amen, and many cultic religion po mga kapatid, have been established here, and guess what? Amen. Kasama din po ang Revised Version doon. That's the opening of the modern versions in the English language. Alam niyo po anong kakontemporary ng AV 1611? Revival. Dahil sa Reformation. Because this is a Reformation Bible. Going back to the Bible. You know what is contemporary sa 1881 na Revised Version? Apostasy. Ang pag-iwan, pagtalikod. Kaya nagsangkatutak ng mga, na-introduce ng mga strange doctrine and ideology at that time po mga kapatid. So now, why I say that this is this. It's important to take note po mga kapatid
Dahil importante ang posisyon ng isang, kanina sinabi ko, importante ang posisyon ng isang translator concerning kung anong posisyon niya sa inspiration. Ngayon po mga kapatid, it is important also to take note po mga kapatid kung ano ang kanyang position patungkol kay Jesus Christ. Ano ang kanyang position patungkol kay Jesus Christ? Importante po ba yun? Yes. Kasi ang modern versions ngayon, ang number one attack po nila is the deity of Christ. You know what the King James Bible is, in what area did the King James Bible stand out compared sa modern version? This Bible over here, this old King James Bible over here exalts the Lord Jesus Christ. This exalts the Lord Jesus Christ. In many areas, marami tayong studies, sa mga previous studies, kinumpare po natin how those modern version have removed the name, not only Jesus, not only Christ, but the Lord Jesus Christ in many areas. How they omitted some verses and some phrases that call Jesus Lord and Christ po mga kapatid, and omitted that and deliberately removed that. And the King James Bible is the one who promoted po mga kapatid and exalts the deity of Christ above all modern version. You know what's the reason why they attack and corrupted the virgin birth, the deity of Christ, and many about the Lord Jesus Christ in modern version? Because the translators were Unitarian. They don't believe in Trinity. They don't believe on the deity of Christ. And guess what? The revised version po mga kapatid, ang mga translators are Unitarian. One of the translators is the one, James Strong, who wrote the Strong's Concordance. They don't believe that Christ is God. And many of these revised version are Unitarian. And you could see there po mga kapatid, that they don't believe that Jesus Christ is God. And it is evident in their translations. And be careful. Ingat po tayo kasi ganun ka-importante. And you know, marami po sa mga translators ng mga modern versions, NIV and many more, they're not even saved. Much more po mga kapatid, they believe Christ to be God. Take note, Westcott and Hort, which is ang Greek text nito, okay, tingnan po natin, ang Greek text nito, makikita po natin is the Erasmus Greek text, isa sa mga Greek text na ginamit. Erasmus, okay, Greek, okay, text. Ang ginamit po dito na Greek text po mga kapatid is the Westcott and Hort Greek text. You know what the Westcott and Hort Greek text is? I gave you the biography of Westcott and Hort in our previews ng mga, ng yung itong Men Behind Our Pure English Bible, yung isa naman na bago tayo pumasok sa lesson na ito, remember that part mga kapatid where we talk about men behind the smoke screen. We talk about some people na ginamit ng Diablo to promote this modern version. We talk about Westcott and Hort. Do you know who they are? They're fanatics of Charles Darwin. Amen. They don't believe on a literal hell. They don't believe on the deity of Christ. They don't believe on the eternal punishment of God. They don't believe on salvation by grace through faith. And guess what? Itong revised version was taken from their work. It becomes, mga kabatid, the 1881. And importante po itong Erasmus na dapat ating tingnan kung sino siya. Kasi dito po kumukuha ang King James Bible, isa sa mga source ng ginagamit ni Wycliffe, ay ni Tyndale, tapos papunta sa AV 1611. Kasi kumuha sila ng 15, Tyndale get this from 1522, and the KJV translators, okay, the KJV translators, dito kumuha sa, mga kapatid, sa 1536. Dito si Tyndale. And guess what? Itong Tyndale Bible po, mga kapatid, ang New Testament, makikita po natin, ay napapunta sa KJV, King James Bible, KJV translator, is about 80% of the New Testament reading of the Tyndale, or 80% of the reading of the King James Bible or the AV 1611 is 80% Tyndale. New Testament, I'm talking about New Testament, 80% Tyndale. And Tyndale get where 1 John 5:7 from Erasmus,
And also with this pumapit, so nakita mo yung influence niya dito sa AV 1611. Kaya very noteworthy na dapat natin i-consider sino ba tong tao na ito. Kasi ito mga Westcott and North, yung behind po mga kapatid. And from 1881, pagkatapos niyan, sangkatutak na ng mga modern version every year ang sumusunod hanggang sa present ngayon. And right now po mga kapatid, right before our time po mga kapatid, there is about, biruin mo naman, for almost 300 years, there's only one English Bible. But look at from 1881 all the way to 2021, for how many years na yan po mga kapatid? More than 100 years na. Amen. There are about, mga kapatid, around 200 different English versions. Think about that. There were 200 from that around, mga kapatid, from this time po mga kapatid, from that time around 200 English versions of the Bible. Now, you think about that, okay? From 1611 all the way to 1880 po mga kapatid. Think about that. When you go to the bookstore, you will have 100% sure that you will have the King James Bible. That you could possess the King James Bible, because from 1611 to 1880, there's only one English Bible. And they call it the book, the old black book, the AV, the authorized version. But starting from 1881 to the present time, there are out now for more than 100 years. Just more than 100 years. There are now around 200 English versions. Now, when you go to the bookstore, from 100%, you could have now 0.5% chance na makakuha ka ng King James Bible. Kita nyo po? Naintindihan po natin? 0.5% na from 100%. Ganun kalala po mga kapatid. And one thing is very, very scary is that you don't even know the lives of these translators. You don't even know their testimonies because they're not recorded in history. Hindi mo mababasa kung paano sila ginamit ng Panginoon. No wonder the NIV has an open lesbian translator by the name of Virginia Mollenkut, who wrote a book that God is a female. Imagine that the Holy Spirit is a female. Whew. And many, hindi mo lang po mga kapatid, napakarami. Natin alam. But praise God po mga kapatid, meron tayong, amen, pwedeng mabasa sa history at patunay po mga kapatid, recorded. Their lives, they have been persecuted. You know, hindi sumikat sila, hindi dahil nagpapasikat sila. You know kung bakit sila sumikat sa history po mga kapatid? Because they make a stand for the truth. They made a decision to make a stand for the truth. Itong tao na ito is misrepresented. Marami tayo dito, Erasmus misrepresented. Pero po, he make a stand. He stood his stand. And ngayon, importanteng malaman kung anong posisyon nila sa deity ni Christ or sino si Kristo sa kanila. And isa pa sa mga qualification, dapat naniwala siya si Kristo ay Diyos at siya ay ligtas. Amen. So, God used Erasmus po mga kapatid to print the purified Greek, the purified Latin, and even Dutch New Testament. And his own writings, ang kanyang mga writings po mga kapatid, reveals mga kapatid, the kind of Christian God entrusted his holy words. It reveals, yung kanyang writing, makikita kaya excerpt ng kanyang mga writing, malalaman mo, makilala mo ang tao by their words. Amen. At ito, it reveals kung anong klaseng mga tao ang ginamit ng Panginoon para po mag-pave the way so that we could have the preserved English Bible in our hand. And sabi ni Erasmus, speaks for himself, sabi ni na isa sa mga biographer niya, si Froude, which is a very corrupt biographer, but he said this area, sabi niya, whenever possible, sabi ni Erasmus, okay, Sabi ni Proud pala, whenever possible, let us not be told about this man or that. But let us hear the man himself speak. Okay? Ito a critic, actually, biographer na kinurap niya yung life ni Erasmus. Pero sabi niya, let us hear the man himself speak. Amen. And let us be left to form our own opinions about him. So of course, let's look at his work. Tama naman si Freud po dun, mga kapatid. So Yale University professor of church history, si Ronald H. Baton, which is also spoken about Erasmus, mga kapatid, in his book on Erasmus of Christendom, that he said that he was a Christian man. And Erasmus was even called as an Anabaptist. So an Anabaptist, sabi niya, one of the terms used in that period to describe true Christians. Oo. So nung ginamit ng Anabaptist, there were people, they're not actually, yun ang mga roots natin. Okay, but they did not call themselves Anabaptist, but they were called by their enemies as Anabaptists. But those are marks that were anti-Catholics back then, were not part of the Catholic Christendom back then. And Erasmus said, in his innocence of life, they excel all others. Sabi ni Erasmus, the Anabaptists excel all others. So taken from a person from that time po, mga kapatid. So he had no vices. Si Erasmus po, mga kapatid, his dream was a return to early Christianity. That's his desire. And as it were, before councils had laid minds of men in chains, a Christianity of practice, not of opinion. Yun po ang desire ni Erasmus po, mga kapatid. He had merely tried to recall men to the original fountain of faith po, mga kapatid. And Erasmus wrote, let me quote, "Would that men were content to let Christ rule by the laws of the gospel." So would that men were content just to let Christ rule. Let Christ rule, amen, by the laws of the gospel. The pietists also found much to their liking in the devotional writings of Erasmus, mga kapatid. Amen. And quotes from Erasmus, many of those writers who quote many of the writings of Erasmus, that will reveal why millions worldwide have been so uplifted by his writings. Sabi niya, let me quote po, mga kapatid. Okay, he wrote, "As to me," this is Erasmus, "all I have sought has been to open my contemporaries' eyes and bring them back from ritual to true Christianity." He said, "Read the Gospels and see how we have degenerated. A man of piety would feel that he could not employ his time better in bringing little ones to Christ. We must forget ourselves and think first of Christ's glory." Okay, we must forget ourselves but think first of Christ's glory. Sabi niya, "He who with full face fixes his eyes upon Christ crucified and fears to crucify him afresh." Imagine, you look at Christ, amen, crucified and fears that you would crucify him afresh. That was an expression used by the book of Hebrews po, mga kapatid, that if you reject what Christ did, you crucify him afresh. Amen. When he considered how much he suffered for us, who was without blemish, he believed that Christ is sinless, without blemish, will surely bear the greater patience, the afflictions of this life. Who would be so inhuman and ungrateful as not to love in turn him who first loved him by such benefits prompted to a life of love. Amen. So makikita natin one historian that giving description to the Christianity of Erasmus, he said, "His confidence is solely in the Lord Jesus Christ who takes away his sins, nailing them to the cross." Amen. "Far be it from me," says he, "that I should come armed with merits." Look at his view on what Christ did. Sabi niya, Far be it from me that I should come armed with merits and briefs to summon my Lord to enter into judgment with his servant, certain as I am that in his sight no man living shall be justified. No man living shall be justified. Mga kapatid, he believed that nobody could save themselves but Christ, because there is no merits. There is no brief to summon my Lord. Amen. To summon my Lord, to call my Lord to save me. There is nothing, mga kapatid. Amen. Makikita po natin po, mga kapatid. Amen. One is baptized into the body of Christ by the Spirit. Amen. Amen. Praise God. And he said, not by Catholic, Lutheran, Anglican, Episcopalian water baptism. Amen. Erasmus wrote about that he did not believe in infant baptism. Amen. And he quoted in his biography, 1 Corinthians 12:13, for by one Spirit are we all baptized in one body. And he said further, our hope lies in God, who freely give us all things through his Son, Jesus Christ. Imagine. By whose death we are redeemed, into whose body we are implanted by baptism, that we should be dead to the lust of the world and live according to his teaching and example, bearing adversity with patience and looking for the recompense of the reward undoubtedly in store for all godly at Christ's coming. So we believe on rewards, but not, amen, not to earn it to be saved, but good works is for reward. Sabi niya, and that we should ever progress from virtue to virtue, ascribing nothing ourselves but whatever is good in us to God. So it is whatever good in us, we ascribe it to God. It is coming from God. Do you see that? Now think about this. He is telling all these things and declaring all these things sa kainitan ng Inquisition, sa kainitan ng persecution, sa burning at stake po, mga kapatid. And bluntly, openly, this is really against Roman Catholic doctrine who preach that salvation is by good works and by their church. Amen. This is the man na we're looking at po, mga kapatid, studying that. And sabi niya, God is far more clement to sinful men if only he repents and despises himself. Amen. Sabi pa niya, Erasmus said, sabi niya, a godly man has no interest in indulgences. His confidence is solely in the Lord Jesus Christ, who takes away his sins, nailing them to the cross. He was preaching against indulgences, that you need to give indulgences and all of that to the church to be saved. But he said, a godly man has no interest in indulgences. His confidence, listen, is solely in the Lord Jesus, who takes away his sin, nailing them to the cross. And kaya sabi ni Erasmus, let us give up the cult of wailing. Ang tawag niya sa mga, Lord, maawa ka sa akin. Ligtas mo ako. Sabi ni Erasmus, let us give up the cult of wailing unless it be for our sins. Amen. May mga ganun, no? Indulgences. Of course, uso yun dati. At ginagamit yung indulgences na yan to build the St. Peter's Basilica, which is now in Italy, in Rome. Amen. And he said, we are assured of victory over death, victory over the flesh, victory over the world and Satan. And Christ promises us remission of sins, fruit in his life, in this life, 100-fold, and thereafter life eternal. And for what reason? For the sake of our merit? He said, no, indeed, but through the grace of faith, which is in Christ Jesus, we are the more secure because he is first our doctor. He first overcame the lapse of Adam, nailed our sins to the cross, sealed our redemption with his blood, which had been confirmed by the testimonies of prophets, apostles, martyrs, and by the universal church of the saints. You believe on the one body, by the universal church of the saints, whom have this. And he added the seal of the Spirit, lest we should waver in our confidence. He believed on eternal security, that he added the seal of his Spirit. Amen. And sabi niya, what could we little worms do for ourselves? Anong tawag niya? What could we, little worms, do for ourselves? Ano magagawa natin? Christ is our justification. Christ is our victory. Christ is our hope and security. Amen. He it is who for us suffer hunger and thirst, is afflicted, endures the agony of death, sweat blood for us, is conquered, wounded, dead, and resurrected, and sits at the right hand of God, the Father. Wow. Those are heavy words. Those are sound words than those who say they're saved by their prayers. They're saved by following a sinner's prayer. Less even sound than that. Kalungkot po mga kapatid, no? And he said, who is all history is like to Jesus. Anong tingin niya kay Christ? Who is all history like to Jesus? Even if you put them together, all history, there's none. It is inconceivably God of God. Who is Christ? Inconceivably God of God. He believed that Christ is God. Before all times, eternal and fully equal to his eternal loftiest parent. So he is eternal and fully equal, amen, to God. Wow, mga kapatid. Anong magagawa mo sa mga kulto? There is this man over here who believe there's far better than the 1881 translators who don't believe that Christ is God. Amen. And sabi niya, by the will of the Father and the breath of the Spirit, he was born of a virgin, a man in time and still God. Wow. Amen. A man in time. Amen. For a few time, a man for 33 years and still God. Amen. And solid by our corruption, who is richer than he who gives all things and is not diminished, who for more illustrious as the splendor of the glory of the Father, enlightening every man that comes into the world. So parang nagbasa ka lang ng Bible sa kanyang statement. Who more powerful than he to whom the Father has given power in heaven and on earth? Who more mighty by those nod the universe was established, at whose nod the sea is calm, diseases flee, armed men fall on their faces, devils are expelled, rocks rent, and the dead raised, sinners repent, and all things are made new. Who is more august, whom angels adore, before whom devils tremble? Wait a minute. It's not my words. I'm just quoting Erasmus. I feel like preaching. This is how we describe Christ. Amen. And sabi niya, who more invincible than he who has conquered death and cast down Satan from heaven? Who more triumphant than he who has harrowed hell? Amen. He believed that he went to hell and brought souls to heaven, where he sits at the right hand of God the Father. Amen. Who is more wise than he who founded and governs the universe in harmony? That was his question. Whose authority is greater than his? Of whom he said, Father, of whom the Father said, this is my beloved Son. Amen. Hear ye him. Who is more to be feared than he who can cast body and soul into hell? Who is more ancient than he who has no beginning and will have no end? But sabi niya, but perhaps boys may be better think of him as a boy, lying in swaddling clothes in a manger, while angels sang, shepherds adored, animals knew him, the stars stood over there he lay, Herod trembled, Simeon embraced, Hannah prophesied. Oh, humble simplicity, oh, sublime humility, how can thoughts conceive or words suffice to express his greatness? Better to adore than to seek to explain. What then shall we do if John the Baptist said he was unworthy to unloose the latchet of his shoes? Strive, my dear boys, to sit at the feet of Jesus. anong sabi mo? This is way earlier than Spurgeon. Pero sino binabasa mo? Parang nagbabasa ka ng Spurgeon. But we are looking at here, Desiderius Erasmus over there. A prominent person na ginamit for King James Bible. Let me add to that. Lastly, sa kanyang part about the Lord Jesus Christ. That's deep, man. That's deep. That's very profound. And I praise God. I'm blessed. Really, reading at his biography, this is written by Froude, The Life and Letters of Desiderius Erasmus. I'm quoting, okay, page 417 po mga kapatid. And the works of Bayton, the professor of Oxford University, in page 102, the biography also of Erasmus. Si Erasmus quoted from Froude po mga kapatid. Sabi niya, "You talk of great name which I shall leave behind me and which posterity is to never let die." Sabi niya, "Very kind and friendly on your part, but I care nothing for fame and nothing for posterity." Sabi niya, "I desire only to go home and to find favor with Christ." Whew! Amen. It's a blessing po mga kapatid. It's a blessing. It's fascinating para sa akin. It's looking at that po mga kapatid, napaka ganda. Amen. Napaka ganda. Amen. Amen. So, we could go on and on sa mga ano po nito. What about, sige, may kaunti pa, Erasmus on Rome. We've done, what about his position on Rome? Amen. Although po mga kapatid, as we learn on the life of Erasmus, dito po, when he was still in that monastery in Holland po mga kapatid, okay, in his early years po mga kapatid, okay, had been hemmed in and hovered by hunting. Alam nyo po, sa nung earlier days niya, meron siyang traumatic experience sa monasteries because of the Catholic monks. He spent his adult life, you know, writing and protesting their false doctrines. And that's why you could read a lot of it and even read you some on our previous ano po discussion about this po mga kapatid. And meron po siyang dalawang book na widely read all over the world po mga kapatid. Ang una is, isa po doon is yung The Praise of Folly and Enchiridion. Okay? And which it records unbridled mockeries of activities of the Catholic Church. And of course, naturally, the Catholic Church would despise that book. Amen. Would ban that book. He wrote that, amen, in 1559. Okay? Makikita po natin. In 1559, that he wrote, he died in 1536. But in 1559, si Pope, Paul IV, sabi niya, place everything Erasmus had written on the index of forbidden books. Lahat ng sinulat ni Erasmus, sinulat po ng Pope, nag-decree po ang Pope, ay forbidden books. So, bakit ganun? Bakit galit na galit? Remember Wycliffe? Na kahit ang buto niya, pinahukay pa rin? And because of his comment on the church, mga kapatid, the Council of Trent condemned Erasmus' translation because it matched that of the true Christians. Kasi it matched of the true Christian and it did not match to their corrupt, okay, Jerome Vulgate translation po mga kapatid. And he was branded as an impious heretic, yun ang tawag sa kanya, and his works were forbidden to Catholic readers. Amen. Ngayon, wala na makapag-forbid, may mga internet na, you know. In Spain, mga kapatid, the monks of Inquisition began a systematic scrutiny of Erasmus' works with a view of having him condemned as heretics. So yun ang ginagawa. Alam niyo po mga kapatid, maraming nagtatawag ngayon ng mga heretics sa mga quote-unquote na mga Bible believer. Alam niyo kung anong strategy na yan para pagbawalan kanila na huwag kang makinig dyan. Heretic yan. Be careful po mga kapatid. They are calling people good people of God, good men. Okay? They're calling them heretics, although they're Bible believers, but they're calling. Bakit? That is to protect themselves na ma-discover ang kanilang kamalian. Yan eh. Ano yan eh? Pangtawag niyan eh, defense mechanism. Amen. And he was attacked with many things, mga kapatid. He was attacked by many things, many areas. Now, if their fables were true, why would the Catholic Church, sabi na kung ganito si kung heretic daw si ganito, ganyan, mali, impious daw at lahat ng ito. Pero kung totoo yung sinasabi nila po, mga kapatid, why would the Catholic Church itself and the scholars of the day consider him as an enemy of that religion? Now, if you read the writings of Erasmus po, mga kapatid, he is an anti-Roman views. Okay? Okay? I'd like you to look at that. For example, Erasmus write about priests, monks, and popes. Anong sabi niya? He's an ex-monk. And he wrote about, Erasmus write about the Reformation. And sabi niya about some monks, po, mga kapatid, until we get rid of the Roman See, ang tawag niya doon, mga Roman See, its satellites, the Dominicans, the Carmelites, the Franciscans, sabi niya, and I don't see how that can be attempted without grave tumult. Magkagulo talaga po, mga kapatid, if you get rid itong mga Dominicans, Carmelites, Franciscans. Sabi niya, you think I am responsible, sabi ni Erasmus, the source lies in the immorality of the priest, the superciliousness of the theologians, and the tyranny of the monks. Are not these enough to provoke tumult? Sabi niya, the shameless of the Roman Curia has reached its climax. Ang titindi. This is unbridled, ano po mga kapatid, scorning and mockeries. Sabi niya, he had employed all his resources of wit and satire against the priests and monks. Yan ang nangyayari po, no? Lahat ng kanyang resources, he spent it by exposing them po, mga kapatid. Amen. And sabi ni Erasmus, what fungus, ang tawag niya doon sa mga ano na yun, mga monks na yun, mga fungus. What fungus could be more stupid? Stupid than these mga monks, mga kapatid. Grabe, it's very, ano po mga kapatid. The Dominicans at once recognized Erasmus, alam niyo po, as one of their most dangerous enemy. His most dangerous enemy. Amen. Erasmus wrote of what he called the hooded whoremasters, the monks. The hooded, yung mga, di ba, mga monks may mga hood. The hooded whoremasters. Amen. Sabi niya, vile rascals are they. Let me quote. Sabi niya, the stupid monks say mass as a cobbler makes a shoe. They come to the altar reeking from their filthy pleasures. Confession with the monks is a cloak to steal the people's money. Pambira. To rob girls of their virtue and to commit crimes too horrible to name. Sabi niya, beware how you offended the monks. You have to do with an enemy that cannot be slain. An order never dies, and they will not rest till they have destroyed you. Grabe, no? I don't think, mga kapatid, meron pa kayang as vocal as Erasmus, as bold as Erasmus sa panahon po natin. Sabi niya, but observe that the monks and the friars had been allowed no voice. With these gentlemen, the world has borne too long. They care only for their own vanity, their own stomachs, their own power. They believe if the people are enlightened, their kingdom cannot stand. Mga kapatid, I'm just quoting the work of men. Sabi niya, I knew a noble woman who gave a large sum to a priest to have masses said for her soul at Rome. Her money might be better have been spent to obligate the priest never to go to Rome. The way to enter paradise is the way to penitent thief. Sabi niya, the way to enter paradise daw is the way to the thief. And in Moria, Erasmus also added and said, he write, they pretend to resemble the apostles. They are filthy, ignorant, impudent vagabonds. They quarrel with each other and curse each other. They pretend to poverty, but they steal into honest men's houses and pollute them, and wasp as they are, no one dares refuse them admittance for fear of their stings. So he described these people as what? As untouchables. Sabi niya, they hold the secrets of every family through the confessional. Yun po, alam niyo po kung bakit hawak ng mga monks ng mga panahon na ito, ng mga priest ng panahon na yun, dahil sa confession. Ikaw, pag mag-confess ka ng isa mong kasalanan, sikreto mo, hawak ka na nila. Okay, hindi ka magbigay ha. Sige, ibunyag ko sa'yo kung anong ginagawa mo, anong mga kasalanan. Remember, alam ko, in-expose na po ito eh, ni Erasmus eh. Ganun na eh. Kikita niya. Okay, through confessional. When they are drunk or wish to amuse their company, they let them out to the world. Naku, pag malasing pala. They let them out to the world. Gagamitin po nila po yun, mga kapatid, is to what? Manipulate. At the same time po, mga kapatid, gamitin nila para mag-take advantage. If any wretched man dares to imitate them, they pay him off from the pulpits. They never stop their barking till you fling them a piece of meat. Ala, tahol lang daw ng tahol yan. Hindi titigil hanggat hindi mo tapunan daw ng meat. Para mga pastors ngayon din yan. Hindi titigil sa kaka-preach sa ano mo hanggat hindi ka magbigay ng pera. Hindi ka titigil babanatan hanggat hindi. Pag hindi ka, nako po, gawin mo lahat ng kasalanan and the pastor is silent. Many pastors, I'm not talking blood, but many of these glutton pastors and of these yung mga filthy lucre na mga pastors, and you are safe. But don't give your tithes and beware. Don't give your tithes, don't give your offering and lagot ka. Tatadta rin ka ng machine gun sa pulpito. Yun po eh. Mayroon ng ganun. Hindi ko sinasabing lahat ha, pero we know na may maraming ganun po, mga kapatid. Nakakalungkot. Hindi ibig sabihin na pastor ka, na ikaw ay okay lahat, or man of God ka, kumbaga Christian ka. No, marami ding corrupt. Hindi lang sa mga monks na ito, but even true sa panahon po natin. Sabi ni Erasmus, the aim of monks is not to benefit men's souls, but to gather harvest out of their purses, learn their secrets, rule their houses. Grabe, no? Yan ang ginagawa. Learn their secrets. Amen. Rule their houses. When you learn their secrets, you can rule their houses. The religious order nowadays came only for money and sensuality. Di ba? Ganun din naman ang mga religions ngayon. Marami pong mga churches ngayon. Amen. The tables of priests and divines run with wine and echoed with drunken noise and scurrilous jests. The reports of the state of morals at Rome have caused vast numbers of men to dislike and even abhor it. Sabi niya, priests who are loose in their lives yet demand to be honored as superior beings have brought their order in contempt. The monks have trusted to their wealth and numbers to crush whom they can no longer deceive. They are now scarcely thought honest men. The Catholic, instead of repenting of their sins, pile superstition on superstition. Yun po ang sabi niya po, mga kapatid. Amen. So marami pong mga quotes, marami po mga kapatid na pwede po nating maisabi. I am saying, bakit importante natin i-quote, isama po ito? Ibig sabihin, hindi po siya influence ng Rome. Kasi marami pong mga misrepresent sa kanya na si Erasmus daw ay Catholic. Si Erasmus daw ay ano po? No, siya nga nag-i-expose eh. Siya nga against eh. Siya nga mismo. Marami kang mga citation. He is a friend to Catholics daw. Yun ang mga critics, ng mga Bible critics na misrepresented by the KJV. Oh, yung kay Erasmus galing. Katoliko naman si Erasmus eh. Monk naman yan si Erasmus. Because they're ignorant eh. They're ignorant. And they chose to whatever, ano po mga kapatid. But how could this be? These quotes be a friend to what they say, mga kapatid. Sabi niya, additional po mga kapatid, sabi niya dito, they know that the whole storm has risen from the pride and self-indulgence of the ecclesiastical order, yet they go on spending, feasting, gambling night after night. The people see it all, yet the clergy think that the revolt can be crushed by force. The only remedy for the heads of the church to mend their ways, but this is the last thing in their thoughts. It is to defy God Almighty. The world cannot overcome the world. They blow their trumpets and say they are making war on heresy. Diba? They say, war on heresy. Sabi nila si Erasmus ay heretic. Heretic. So they said, they blow their trumpet and say they making war on heresy. The war will be on their own revenues and power and idle pressures. Our pleasures. Mga kapatid, marami din nagsasabi niya, oh, heresy yan, heretic yan, most heretic yan. And I tell you something, marami sa nagsasabi dun, mga money machine, ginagawang gatasan ang marami sa kanila. Ang alam niyo po, mahirap na, no? Mahirap mga ganun. No? Dami palang mga kalokohan pagdating sa pera. Mga ganun lang din yun. They ought to be preaching the gospel, sabi ni Erasmus, and you find them instead hunting princes' courts and rich men's houses. So anong ginagawa nila? They're hunting princes. Ano yung mga prince na ito po, mga kapatid? Sa mga hari, mga lahat na. Pupunta po sila doon kasi malaking makukuha. Parang ganun lang yung mga pastors ngayon eh. Nananaga ng naghahanap, namimili ng magagandang isda, yun daw yung mga nasa ano, yung mag-soul winning ka daw sa mga mayayaman. Of course, ang mga mayayaman kailangan nating i-soul winning. Pero may special treatment sila. Alagaan natin to kasi malaki to magbigay. Anong pinag-iba natin po mga kapatid kung ganun ang ating konsepto sa mga monks na ito? Amen. God help us, mga kapatid. Kaya sabi niya, those wretches in the disguise of poverty are tyrants of the Christian world. Kasi mga monks, di ba? The disguise of poverty, pero sila yung pinakamaraming pera. Amen. Sabi niya, behind the monks are crafty, influential men who have the Pope's ears and urge him into dangerous courses. They forget Christ and preach preposterous doctrines of their own invention. Amen. Amen. There might still be hope if the Pope trusted in Christ. Alas, he trusts more in his cardinals and in the wicked monks whose depravity has caused the whole disturbance. Napakadami. Erasmus about the Pope. About the Pope, sabi niya, Erasmus calls the papacy, anong tawag niya sa papacy? The synagogue of Satan. He described the Pope Julius excluded from heaven at his death. So sabi niya, hindi maligtas yan at hindi makapasok sa langit yan. They're synagogue of Satan. That's how. Those are not my words. We're studying the man's words po, mga kapatid. So don't reckon it to me po, mga kapatid. Amen. So he also preached against mga sa pagwo-worship ng Virgin Mary at pagwo-worship ng mga images. Ang dami po niyang mga ano po mga kapatid. Ang dami po niyang mga citation patungkol po diyan po mga kapatid. So we don't have to go there po mga kapatid. Okay, Erasmus also write an anti-Catholic study Bible. He wrote an anti-Catholic study Bible. Erasmus added more notes. Most of those notes na kanyang nilagay doon sa anti-Catholic Bible po niya po mga study Bible is most notes exposed the crimes of the Catholic Church, whose awful countenance was now practically revealed for the first time for many centuries. Think about that. From 15, remember, part pa siya, ipinanganak siya ng 1500, ay, 1466, naabutan pa niya ang Dark Ages, which is, ang Dark Ages is from 500 AD to 1500 po mga kapatid. Naabutan pa niya. At ano pong mga time na yun? Wala pong magdi-dare na atakihin, magsulat against except kina Wycliffe and all of that. But for the first time or in few instances, there is this one man who wrote against it. Amen. Who dare to challenge the Catholic Church. Because, you know, from that years, mga kapatid, napaka-dangerous that who fight against, kasi you will be in danger of being martyred, okay, or being ano po mga kabatid. So they were deliberate accusation, attacks to the sacred text. At marami po siyang may comment siya sa Matthew chapter 19 verse 12. Ito yun ha, ito yung citation from his study Bible. And Matthew 19:12 sabi na, which have made themselves eunuch for the kingdom of heaven. Remember, made themselves eunuch for the kingdom of heaven. Ang comment niya, sabi niya, men are threatened or tempted into vows of celibacy. They can have license to go with harlots, but they must not marry wives. Wow. Sabi niya, men are threatened into vows of celibacy. They can have license to go with harlots, but they must not marry wives. They may keep concubines and remain priests. If they take wives, they are thrown into the flames. This is his comment, which made themselves eunuch for the kingdom of heaven. In Matthew 23 po mga kapatid, you know, it talks about the scribes and the Pharisees. Sabi niya, you may find a bishop here and there who teaches the gospel, though life and teaching have small agreement. But what shall I say of those who destroy the gospel itself, make laws at their will, tyrannize over the laity, and measure right and wrong with rules constructed by themselves, of whose who entangled their flocks in the meshes of crafty canons, who sat not on the seat of the gospel, but in the seat of the Caiaphas and Simon Magus, prelates of evil who bring disgrace. That's his comment on Matthew 23. Look at Matthew 23, verse number 27. The Bible says, woe unto you Pharisees and scribes and hypocrites, for ye are like unto the whited sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but are within full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanness. So anong comment ni Erasmus po doon? He said, the avarice of priests and the hypocrisy of monks playing on the credulity of the people, even bishops play their parts in these fantastic shows. Fantastic shows. Diretso ha, sino yung mga monks, mga bishop, diniretso po niya. His comment on Matthew 24:23. The Bible says, then if any man shall say unto you, Lord, lo, here is Christ, or there, believe it not. So anong comment niya? I saw with my own eyes Pope Julius II of Bologna and afterwards at Rome marching at the head of triumphal procession as if they were Pompey or Caesar. Peter subdued the world with faith if they had Peter's spirit po mga kapatid. Sa kanila, but they reign like kings. And they say that they're the vicar of Christ but they act like kings. Sabi niya, if Peter subdued the world with faith, amen. Peter subdued. They're not actually following followers of Peter. Sabi niya, 1 Corinthians, comment niya sa 1 Corinthians 14:19. The Bible says, yet in the word, I had rather speak 5 words with many understanding, with my understanding, not by my voice, I preach to teach others also, than 10,000 words in an unknown tongue. Anong comment niya doon? They chant nowadays in our churches, in what is known tongue or unknown tongue, Latin, Hebrew, and etc. Take note on this. Sabi niya, while you will not hear a sermon once in 6 months telling people to amend their lives. Amen. Modern church music is so constructed that congregation cannot hear one distinct word. Remember yung mga Gregorian chant? Hindi mo nga daw sabi niya, modern music nang tawag niya. I'm talking of 1500. Modern music nang tawag niya dun. Sa mga Gregorian chants na yon na hindi mo daw maintindihan, puro lang mga naka soprano na iskrumpaktum rebrebeticum. The choristers, sabi niya, themselves do not understand what they are singing, yet according to priests and monks it constitute the whole of religion. Why will they listen to Paul? Why will they not listen to Paul? Words were then pronounced plainly, words nowadays mean nothing. They are mere sounds striking upon the ear, and men are to leave their work and to go to church to listen. Worse noises than were ever heard in Greek and Roman theater. Yan po eh. Yan po nangyayari. Kaya sabi niya, money must be raised to train boys to squeal. The laity are burdened to support miserable, poisonous, corybants, and even poor starving creatures might be fed at the cost of them. A set of creatures who ought to be lamenting their sins fancy they can please God by girdling their throats. Boys are kept in English Benedictine colleges solely and simply to sing morning hymns to the Virgin. So if they want music, let them sing psalms. Amen. Sabi niya. Like rational beings. So ibig sabihin niya, parang mga baliw lang daw mo mga kapatid pag kumakanta. Grabe naman tong comment na yun. Sabi niya, if they want music, let them sing psalms like rational beings. And sabi niya, ang comment niya sa Ephesians 5:4 says, neither filthiness nor foolish talking nor jesting which are not convenient but rather giving of thanks. Erasmus said po mga kapatid, monks and priests have the detestable tricks of burlesquing scripture. When they wish to be specially malicious, they take thou God and introduce infamous words into them and making themselves as hateful when they would be witty as even as when they are serious. So, of course, in 1 Timothy 1:6, sabi niya, from which some swerve have turned aside unto vain jangling. Ang comment niya, can a pope make a decree which contradicts the gospel? Is he quasi-God or compared with Christ? The best of men but worms. The best of men but worms. Marami po. Comment niya sa 1 Timothy chapter number 3 verse 2. A bishop then must be blameless. The husband of one wife. Ito ha, nasa Greek New Testament to, mga notes po niya ito. Ang comment niya, homicide, parricide, incest, piracy, sodomy, sacrilege, this cannot be get over. But marriage is fatal. There are priests now in vast numbers, innermost herds of them, seculars and regulars, and it is notorious that very few of them are chaste. The great proportion fall into lust and incest. And open profligacy, it would surely be better if those who cannot contain should be allowed lawful wives of their own. O nga naman, bakit mo naman pagpipigilan na mag-asawa? Kaya sabi niya, amen. It would surely be better if those who cannot contain should be allowed lawful wives of their own and so escape this foul and miserable pollution. Such of our modern clergy, such themselves out of mischief, do it more from fear of the law than from conscience. They dread losing their benefits or missing their promotions, po mga kapatid. So, nakakalungkot, how could these KJV critics write about Erasmus pretending po mga kapatid that he was lifelong devoted Catholic? Why is that? Paano nagiging Catholic si Erasmus when he rejected by the Catholics as subversive po mga kapatid? And because this James White over here, si Kotelik po mga kapatid, these are mga Bible critics, King James critics, because they do not cite the primary sources of his biography. Yan po yung problem po. Paano mo i-acquaint po niya na galit siya? How about kay Luther? By the way, wala na tayong time po mga kapatid. Hindi natin pupuntahan. He has a lot of things, mga kapatid, na masasabi kay Luther. Marami po siyang, sabi niya kay Luther, dearest brother in Christ, your epistle showing the keenness of your mind and breathing a Christian spirit was most pleasant to me. And you have friends here too, me particular. So sabi niya, I affirm my friends ka dito. Remember, sa time po na yan, that's the time of Reformation, and lumabas po si Luther. Kaya sabi niya po mga kapatid, sabi niya, Erasmus would not attack Luther or wrote against Luther. Sabi niya, the world has been besotted with ceremonies, miserable monks have ruled all, entangling men's conscience for their own benefit. Dogma has been heaped on dogma. The bishops have been tyrant. The pope's commissaries have been rascals. Luther has been an instrument of God's displeasure, like Pharaoh or Nebuchadnezzar or the, ano po mga kabatid? Caesar, I shall not attack him on such grounds as this. Kasi tawag kay Luther a troublemaker, sabi niya, I will not attack him like that ground po mga kabatid. Sabi niya, Luther has taken up the cause of honesty, the good sense against abomination, which are no longer tolerable. His enemies are men under whose worthlessness the Christian world has grown too long. May Christ direct Luther's action to God's glory and confound those who are seeking their own interest in Luther's enemies. I perceive more of the spirit of the world than the spirit of God. You see that? Kumampi po siya kay Luther po mga kapatid. Amen. Actually, willing siya bayaran ng Pope pa mga kapatid para magsulat against kay Luther. Pero he denied that po mga kapatid. Sabi niya, I perceive that a better man was the less he was Luther's enemy. Kung ikaw ay, sabi niya, matinong tao, kung ikaw ay tamang tao, you will not hate Luther, sabi niya. You will not be Luther's enemy. Ganun din naman eh, kung matinong tao yung mga nagtatawag na mga heretics at mga demonic mga kapatid, they will not hate those who preach the gospel. They will not say that to those good men po mga kapatid. Amen. The world was sick of teaching which gave it nothing but glosses. The word in the original has the sense and formulas was thirsting after the water of life from the gospel and epistles. A few person only were clamoring at him in alarm for their own pockets. Kaunti lang naman. There are person calling themselves bishop whose moral character is abominable. Can it be right to persecute a man and blemished life in whose writings distinguished and excellent persons have found so much to admire? Kaya sabi niya, how could you ano po persecute a man who has that unblemished life? So, sabi niya Erasmus wrote, kasi inutusan siya ng isang pope na atakihin si ano po si Luther. Sabi niya, if you mean to try prison, lashes, confiscation, stake and scaffold, you need no help from me. Amen. Wala, hindi na nag-respond po mga kapatid. Lahat po ng iyon. Alam niyo po kung ano lang ang against niya. Sabihin ko na sa iyo, then close po natin. Alam niyo kung anong against niya kay Luther? Ano lang against siya kay Luther? On the doctrine of predestination. Because si Luther is like Calvin who believe on pre-selected. But Erasmus, mga kapatid, believes on free will. That is one thing that he could not agree with Luther. But he don't agree that Luther must be persecuted and be attacked by the Catholic. But he don't agree po mga kapatid sa kanya pong, sa kanilang belief doon sa, okay, yung may preselected ang Panginoon na pupunta ng langit at pupunta ng impyerno po mga kapatid. Erasmus could not conform to Lutheran and Catholic view even in communion, even dito sa ano po mga kapatid. So hindi siya pwedeng maka ano po doon. Kasi si Luther naniniwala din ng communion. Si Luther sometimes believe also po mga kapatid na may mga images. Si Erasmus hindi. Bakit? Bakit iba si Erasmus? Kasi ang kanyang orientation ay Anabaptists. Anabaptist po ang kanyang orientation, kaya ganun po mga kapatid. So he could not conform to many of that, yung mga maraming sacraments. He could not conform on that. And maganda sana to mga kapatid. Tingnan natin kung mapasadahan ko to next ano po mga kapatid. Pero we will talk about next week kay William Tyndale na po. Pero tingnan natin, marami pong mga misrepresentation kay Erasmus. Ang tawag sa kanya ay humanist. By the way, ang humanist ngayon at humanist dati ay iba. Ang humanist dati po mga kapatid is a classical scholar, which is true kay ano, kasi nag-aaral siya ng classical Greek. Latinist or a professor or teacher of Latin, humanist din siya. Okay, and another is a philologer, a grammarian, yun po yung ibig sabihin ng humanist. Pero sa time po ng 1800 pataas, ang humanist iba na. Yun yung mga humanistic na mga ano po, mga kapatid. So don't be fooled kagad. Oh, si Erasmus pala. Erasmus the humanist. Magbasa ka ng mga Google, pupunta, mag-search ka na yung life. Erasmus the humanist. Pero kung wala kang pagkaintindi kung anong ibig sabihin ng humanist nila, ang thinking mo, ganun? Akala ko ba, nag-ano, paano ang isang humanist magsulat ng Greek Bible? Paano mangyayari yun? Kasi ang humanist na nasa isip natin, iba. Po mga kapatid. He was misrepresented by his translators. Marami sa kanyang mga Bible at mga preachings translate sa ibang pamamaraan. He was misrepresented by his biographers. Maraming nagsusulat ng kanyang buhay pero iba ang binibigay. Catholic inclined or enemies inclined sa enemy or mga enemies niya ang nagsusulat ng kanyang biography. And marami pong nag-misrepresent sa kanya sa kanyang critics at saka mga marami sa KJV critics. His forgers. He was misrepresented by his forgers. He was also misrepresented by his charity. Alam niyo po, dahil charitable actually itong si ano eh. Hindi ka agad itong makipag-discuss at all of that. Pero they took advantage on that. Yun ang nangyayari sa mga pastors ngayon. They took advantage of our charity. Kaya nga, because we are sheep, kaya nga sabi sa quotation po niya doon po mga kapatid, I may be a sheep, amen, but sheep can also bleat. Amen. Kasi because of his charity and because of his style also po mga kapatid, ng pagsusulat and all of that, he was misrepresented na ganito daw ganyan. So wala nang, hindi na natin maano po yun mga kapatid. Wala na tayong ano po dyan, no? So, anim po yun, no? By his forgers and lahat po nang yun. Okay? So, finally po mga kapatid, okay? Let us, by the way, he died po mga kapatid. Kung if you take as a whole, I will end na lang dito, no? If you take as a whole, it is quite clear that Erasmus is a strong opponent of activities of unscriptural belief of the Catholic Church. That is one thing na remarkable sa kanya. He loved their people. He loved the Catholics. But he hated the error that would resign them to an eternity without Christ. He hated those who manipulated those people po mga kapatid. Okay, Erasmus was rejected by the Catholics as subversive and by the Protestant as evasive po mga kapatid. Perhaps it was because he was neither, amen, a Protestant. He was neither a Catholic. He was a Christian in views and a piety seen in an Anabaptist historic position. Erasmus has the highest respect for the Anabaptists and insisted that they were simply Baptists, po mga kapatid. And it has been the purpose of, mga kapatid, it has not been the purpose of this lesson to defend Erasmus or come to any judgment about him. But Erasmus and his ink will defend himself. I could not defend Erasmus. It was his writing that I was reading to you. It was his works that I was reading to you. He was defending himself. Mga kapatid, I was not creating words for him, but he was just saying it to themselves. And listen, but they are not to be equated as the pure river of life, the word of God. Of course, he is man. He is fallible, po mga kapatid. And it appears, mga kapatid, but this man is noble. Is a noble man, an honest man. And yet we have been led to believe by this misrepresentation, by the scoffers, that he's not like what he say he is. Mga kapatid. But it's wrong, mga kapatid. Kaya nga sabi ng Matthew 27:13, hearest thou that not many things they witness against thee? Kasi when you talk about history, depende po kung sinong nagsulat niyan eh. May marami pong mga ano. So, sabi ng mga King James translators, mga kapatid, sa translators to the reader, sabi niya, envy striketh most spitefully at the fairest and at the chiefest. Pag may envy, ganun talaga eh. And Erasmus said also, let me quote, sabi niya, I can keep my own innocency. I cannot help what men say about me. Amen. I cannot help. Of course, he has a lot of enemies. Considering yung position na yun, it could draw a lot of enemies po mga kapatid. But sabi niya, I can keep my own innocency. I cannot help what men say about me. Wala tayong control kung anong sasabihin ng iba. Amen. But we could hold our peace. Praise God. Amen. Erasmus died, but estranged from the Catholic Church. He was banned by the Catholic Church. Mga kapatid. Amen. And in the midst of a group of Protestant scholars who had been his truest friends. Amen. Sabi niya, so far as is known, without relation of any sort with the Roman Catholic Church. Sabi niya. Ay, sabi ng mga historians, he died without any relation. So he died at Basel in 1536 po mga kapatid. And committed to neither party. Amen. But amid of admiring circle of friends who were all reformed side. They're all reformers po mga kapatid. So a Protestant pastor preached his funeral service mga kapatid. And sabi po niya, that the money he left was used to help Protestant refugees. That was what the pastor was preaching at his funeral, that the money he left was used to help Protestant refugees. So, finally, Erasmus reminds us all, and he said, let us not forget that speedily we shall all stand before that judge whose judgment is just. Amen. And the word, of course, we will stand before God. We will stand before the Lord Jesus Christ one day. Let us not forget that speedily. That's his mungkahi. Because we know in John 12 verse number 48, we know that verse. You were familiar with that verse. That the word that I have spoken, sabi ng Panginoon, the same shall judge him in the last days. Amen. So, of course, he will be judged if he's lying. He'll be judged before God. But we have his personal biography and all of that written, and he's defending himself. Now, one thing, I found a reliable man whom I could associate my faith with, whom my Bible is associated with, a faithful, a noble, a servant of God, amen, who is against the errors, amen, from the scriptures. And who exposed men, who loved Christ, amen, who were honest sa kanilang works and all of that, at yet ginagamit po naman. No wonder, ganun po kadami ang na-influence at kaganda po ang naituro po niya. And mga kapatid, thank you for listening, thank you for enduring po mga kapatid. I hope history will not bore you, but this is part of learning. Kailangan nating makita po itong mga bagay na ito. And praise the Lord po mga kapatid sa buhay na pinag-aralan po natin nito. Next week, we will talk about William Tyndale po mga kapatid. We'll talk about William Tyndale. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Thank you Panginoon sa reminder sa amin. And thank you sa paggamit niyo sa isang tao na ito. Although sinner, saved by grace Panginoon, pero ginagamit niyo siya mightily. Ganon din niyo kami sana magamit Panginoon. Bless you po, Lord, ang mga lesson pa namin, even tomorrow and the rest of this week. Bless your people now and help us to rejoice in you. And this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless us, brethren. And thank you very much and have a good day. Amen. See you next time. We're done here, Brother Joms.
Sure. Thank you.
Okay, salamat.
Pwede po yung maka-screenshot ulit, Rog.
Ay, okay.
Okay, tapos na po. I-close ko na po yung meeting.
God bless. Thank you, Brother Elmer.
Elmer, bye-bye. Bye-bye, everyone.